Hello and welcome to this week's edition of Twa Teams, One Street. I'm Tom Duthie, and podcasting alongside me today are George Cran.
Hello.
Graeme Finnan.
Hello, everyone.
And with Alan Temple sunning himself on a beach somewhere in the Lothians, Craig Cairns.
Hello.
Long time no see, Craig. How are you?
Very well, thanks. How are you doing?
Oh, you've not got enough time. It's only meant to be an hour long, this
that
podcast,
was the wrong
mate.
Question, Craig.
Anyway, before we get down to business, and given the midweek results, we'll keep this bit as long as possible before we have to start speaking about football. A couple of public service announcements. Remember, you can watch us on YouTube, which is quite good because if the topic of conversation is boring, you can count my chins. And also, do you realise this is a first for the podcast? We've never recorded a podcast on February 29th before. So, and by the way, ladies, just to avoid disappointment, I'm already unhappily married, so no proposals today, thanks very much.
Tanya listens to this podcast, doesn't she?
No.
She may be in trouble.
She hates football more than she hates me. Right, I suppose we'll have to speak about football now,
The leap year special is going to be miserable.
I know, well... Craig, I assume that at Tannadice on Tuesday there were no proposals, but there'd be a few profanities because 2-0 defeat to Airdrie was not what United wanted.
No, and it was unlike the Wraith defeat in that the performance wasn't there either. They got into some good positions at times in the game, but there was no final ball, or there was nobody on the cutback or the cross. The second half, they just didn't really get going at all. Airdrie were much better on the ball, again, without creating a huge amount, but they took advantage of a United mistake and got the ball in the net. The second goal doesn't really matter. It's similar to a game earlier, sort of the reverse earlier in the season when United were 1-0 up in the dying minutes and Airdrie were chasing and they made it 2-0.
Yeah.
It was a very similar goal to that, the second one. So, not too much in the game, but I think the real disappointment was that not only did they not take any points from the game, that there really wasn't a performance there to take any positives from.
And, Pear, it's another problem game at Tannadice.
Mm-hmm.
Don't anybody faint, but I was looking at a few statistics. United have now dropped 13 points at home as opposed to 5 away. And, of course, statistics are the thing in the modern game. The average 1.69 points at home and 2.42. Now, obviously, that's all. A lot of that can be dismissed, but they're almost a point a game worse off at home. It's not how to win promotion, is it?
No, it's a home form.
Certainly not make it easy.
Yeah, home form continues to haunt Jim Goodwin and Dundee United. And I don't really know the reason behind it, because they got fabulous support at Tannadice. Jim Goodwin seems to have pinpointed the fact that they're maybe a bit laborious when they're in possession at Tannadice. And I don't know, maybe that's because teams tend to sit in a wee bit more, so they find themselves with a bit more space, you know, from the back and along the back line. So instead of being proactive, they tend to spend a wee bit too long on the ball. And as such, they're not opening teams up. They're not dragging teams about as quickly as they should. And it's a real frustration for their fans. You can sense that, you know, at Tannadice, you know, the performances when they're getting 7,000 and 8,000 for their home games, and it's something they need to sort out pretty soon. We're in the home straight. I always say, you know, you can't afford to fall off the pace. When you're in the home straight in a two-horse race, normally the horse that takes the lead goes on and wins, so you can't afford to slip behind. So, you know, while it was a disappointing defeat, what I will say is, Airdrie are a good side. I've been impressed with Airdrie all season. They've beaten Dundee, they've beaten St Johnstone. That shows how good a side they are. They like playing football. I think you can get at them because they tend to take risks at the back, because that's the way Rhys McCabe wants them to play. But they're a difficult team because they do keep the ball. They don't just kick it away. But it's a poor result for United. The only positives I could take from it is the fact that Wraith Rovers didn't pick up full points and jump above them in the table. And it's the home form is a real concern for Jim Goodwin at this point in time. It's something they need to address very quickly.
Aye. George, as Bear says, Airdrie are a good side. They're a possession-based side, if you like. But one thing, and I've down the years, I've been critical of the Championship, but one thing I've noticed, and or I noticed in my time, as the years passed, a lot of Championship teams are good at keeping the ball. Mm-hmm. Their problem is the problem that United have just now, is turning that in, that possession into goals. But if you're Airdrie away from home, you're not chasing goals. You're making sure that you keep a clean sheet and hoping for goals. United need to find a way, don't they?
They do. And they've got the players to do it. I think we all know that. It's just putting it all together. It's the issue at the moment. I do like Airdrie, as Pierre says. I was really impressed with them against Dundee. It was way back in the League Cup group stage. But I thought their movement in midfield was excellent. They opened up great big spaces in the middle of the Dundee's midfield. I don't know if they were doing that on Tuesday with United, but Dundee back then really struggled to deal with their movement, and it probably was the quality of their players in the end that meant that Airdrie didn't really make the most of that, and Dundee should have won that game. They ended up losing it with a penalty, but they're a good side. Having watched the Championship so many years, I've seen this before in terms of the sort of, me and Bear were talking before the podcast about exactly this time last year, Dundee got beat at home by Partick Thistle 3-1, and everything looked bleak and folk are having a go at the manager and all sorts, and then suddenly they got a win on the Saturday and they didn't lose another game all season and they kicked on. So it wouldn't surprise me if United do that, but it's up to them to go and actually start doing that. It maybe helps them actually being away from home for the next couple, although they're tough games, Partick Thistle and then Morton. They enjoyed their trip to Partick a lot earlier this season, so they'll be home to do that again.
Nobody enjoys a trip to Morton.
Not even Morton.
No.
No. Nah, they do this season. To be fair, Morton have been very good.
Yeah, and it's always a tough one. It doesn't matter where Morton are. I mean, it's even worse that Morton are going well just now because it's always a hard game.
And it's third against fourth. I mean, which tells you they're two of the better sides in the division.
They do like going to Partick Thistle.
Exactly.
Very often, so hopefully Saturday.
Yeah.
I think last time they went to Partick and it was a very good win, the pressure was on too. Mm-hmm. But they made it, it was almost a statement win last time at Thistle.
Thistle, a bit of a sticky run themselves. No, I'm always wary when you play teams that are on a sticky run because it has to Partick.
Bear, just more of Dundee later.
Yeah. we'll get there.
Just to add to what has been said about Airdrie there, they are a good footballing team, but they've got a lot of streetwise players in their team as well. They're quite a short team, but like I say, that's why McCabe plays the way he does, because he's got a lot of short players. But like I say, there's lots of streetwise players within that sort of possession-based approach. And they've beaten Raith three times this season. They've beaten them 1-0, and I think they drew the other game with them. So there was the Challenge Cup game, and I think off the top of my head, I think the three league games, they've beaten them 1-0 twice and drawn with them. So they can be a very handy side on their day, as you kind of pointed out their cup results earlier. They've had some impressive ones in the league as well.
Now, I agree completely with my journalist's head on with what Craig just said. But as a Dundonian and a fan of a team in this city, my response is, I bet it's Airdrie. I don't care when.
Yeah.
I don't care where, when or how United play Airdrie. As a fan, I expect them to win.
Yeah.
And that's not fair. It's not giving Airdrie the respect they're due, but it's something United have to live with. And Declan Gallagher's touched on this. There is an expectancy there, and it'll never, ever change. I mean, Dundee have been on the verge of bankruptcy in the Championship at times, and they're still expected to beat everybody unless there's a Hearts, a Hibs, or a United in that league that fans consider another Premier League team. If it's an Airdrie, a Raith, a Morton, as hard as we say it's to go to Capello, fans in this city expect their team to win, and that's something United are going to have to live with over the next few weeks.
Yeah, but the weight of expectation is something United have to carry. Jim Goodwin knows that. He'll have drummed that into the players. The weight of expectation can't drag you down.
No.
It can't. You know, you've got to live with that. The players he's signed have got to be aware of that. They're coming to the biggest club in the Championship. And when they go in that park, their fans expect them to win every single game. Now, that isn't never going to happen all the time. That's never possible. But United at home do seem to have an issue now. And is it because the expectation's too great, or is it because the way United's set up at home? I don't know, Tom. And Jim Goodwin must be scratching his head on how they sort that. I mean, we spoke last week about Jim Goodwin and the game at Wraith, and was it time for United to maybe change it slightly? And, you know, Alan says, well, I'm not sure, and it could be, and they did. They changed it for the game against Queen's Park and it looked like they had a really comfortable victory against Queen's Park. And then I think Jim Goodwin let quite a few of the players go for it a second time and it just doesn't pay off. So where does he go? Does he revert to maybe more experienced guys and try and squeeze the most out of them for the run-in, or does he keep persevering with younger players who may be affected a bit more by expectation and trying to get a result?
I remember United were good enough to invite myself and the aforementioned unhappy wife who took a book when I retired. And it was a game against Queen of the South, John.
I did that game. I remember you waving at me
yes,
from across the stadium.
I was. Yeah. It was great because you could see the clock on the side of the stadium I was. But I remember in that game, I think United were one up. I think it finished 1-0, did it?
I can't remember.
Anyway, they were one up very, very late in the game, and the United fans were wanting more goals. Benjamin Segrist, great performer for United. The crowd got to him a wee bit, and he started booting the ball the length of the park because the fans wanted a second goal. And I always remember Callum Butcher, I could hear him shouting. Callum Butcher turned around at him and said, what are you doing? Keep the ball. And it takes that kind of character at times. It's great. The support that United get is fantastic. I would not at all be critical of them. But does it take a player at times if they're one up, or even like Tuesday if they're one down, keep the head, keep doing the right things and not react to that pressure
to
get the ball up the park?
Players in the team with experience that should be passing that on to the younger players. The guys like Declan Gallagher, Kevin Holt, Louis Moult, Wotherspoon, Sybald in the middle of the park, you know, Doherty when he's fit. So there's enough players there to say, look, what we're doing here, let's not lose sight of what we're trying to achieve here. You know, we'll get the victory, but do what we've done well in the past. I think it's probably quite a good thing. I think United's next two games are on the road. Because that's where their best form has been this season. You know, they've been fantastic away from home. But it's a couple of massive games for them. There can be no doubt about that coming up. You know, and as I say, it's on a knife edge at this point in time. But what you cannot afford to do is fall behind.
And it's that time of the season too where you're looking for them to ground out wins, aren't you? It's not. Earlier in the season, there was fives and sixes, and that's great.
You take... grinding's exactly the way I said Dundee won the championship last season. The ground out towards the end of the season. George mentioned that end of February, they lost to Partick. Mm. They never lost another game. But it wasn't through sheer brilliance, the ground out results. I remember them being 3-1 down at home to Morton at one point and snatching a point with the last kick of the ball. You know, nothing's up against Cove Rangers. It wasn't pretty, but they managed to get themselves over the line. And, you know, I think, encouragingly for Dundee United, I don't think Wraith Rovers are setting the heather on fire at this point in time.
It's way to say, Craig, you've seen a bit of Wraith as well. I mean, normally at this time of the season, you're waiting who's going to crack, who's going to break, whose nerves going to go. It's almost the opposite. Are the two teams, who would you back to hold their nerve or find their nerve at the minute?
I think there's still a lot of questions to be asked that Wraith, right now, what kind of form they're in, because if you look at the last three, they've drawn 1-1-1 and lost one, haven't they, I think? And then there was just a...
If you go back further, the form's even worse, isn't
it? And just before that, there was their run of five defeats in a row, including two cup competitions, I think, that run included. So, yeah, I think we're still waiting to see how Wraith have come out that poor run, exactly. I still think Dundee United, if all those things that you guys have been talking about, if they can sort of hold their nerve, if they can use the experience they have and the team that they didn't have at this point last season when they were in a relegation battle, Jim Goodwin's really made a point of bringing in those kind of characters for these kind of scenarios. But yeah, I would still think that Dundee United, what they're doing is a bit more sustainable and probably be enough to get them over the line. Yeah, but we still don't know what kind of Wraith has come out of that run. They've added a defender who, as we'll come on to later, may not appear for them again towards the end of the season, for the rest of the season. Yeah. So who knows how the rest of their season is going to turn out. But I think, yeah, if I was putting money on it, I would probably still stick with Dundee United at this point.
Yeah, I mean, that's an interesting one, because you look at United, I mean, that my usual ridiculous confidence, a lot of it was based on Declan Gallagher, Kevin Holt, Docherty, Sibbald, players like that, Moulton, Watt, to get goals when they were needed. Maybe not a barrel load of goals, but the ones that give you the 1-0s and the 2-1s. And I must admit, what surprised me most on Tuesday was not the United nil. It was the fact that Airdrie got two. And with Gallagher back in the team, and I was ultra confident that United would go on and clinch this league. I'm not so confident now, George.
Well, that's the man that said they'd win the league by October.
Stayed me a February. It only happens once every 4 years.
I do think the second goal, not to like take a, I'm not trying to put a gloss on it, but the second goal was definitely inconsequential the match. And like I say, you could say the same about earlier in the season.
Especially with their goal difference anyway, if you're not taking a risk at 1-0 down in an injury time with that kind of goal difference advantage over the rest.
You mentioned Gallagher, he was playing up front at that point, so he couldn't really do anything about that goal they conceded at the end. So yeah, I mean, it's still a terrible result, but it was one goal. It was half as bad as you're making it.
The other thing that interested me about Gallagher's return was Jim Goodwin's handling of it, with saying that Ross Graeme had a right to be angry. I must admit, I would be saying to Ross Graeme, well, if you've done what Declan Gallagher's done, you get right back in the team after you've been out injured a while.
Yeah, I mean...
And that's no pop at Ross Graeme. He's a young boy. But, I mean, at any level, you're... What Declan Gallagher is to Dundee United means as soon as he's ready to play 70 minutes,
he's a senior, he gets 90. He's a senior player in that position. And I think Ross Graeme would recognise that as well. He's no mug.
He was maybe, Jim Goodwin, in fairness, was maybe giving you boys a nice story. And I'd said that to Ross
but
Graeme.
I think that I've been really pleased with Ross Graeme when he came in. I think when he first came in, he would maybe struggle to... Because he hadn't played so much, he wasn't quite at his top performance. But I obviously haven't seen a huge amount of United, but against Wraith, I was quite impressed with him. It looks like he's kind of broadened out. He's a lot more stocky than that. Now, I noticed when there was just a picture of him, I thought, like, oh, he's quite big these days, after not seeing him since last season. So I think... probably. It's maybe a decision to make for Goodwin, but I'm guessing he'll stick with his experienced player. I mean, Kevin Holt's got a hat-trick at Partick Thistle last time. Not sure he'll do it again, but you never know.
One of them was ridiculous. Was it not come across? Have you missed it and I hit him on the knee or something and ended up in the back of the net?
One of them was a screamer as well.
Yeah, yeah.
See, there's the Dundee fan. One of them was from about 40 yards. But Bear goes with a fluke. Holt scored his career best goal and it's forgotten.
I like Kevin Holt. I liked him when he's at Dens, and he's done a great job for United. And I think you're right, George. I think Jim Goodwin will. It's just two main men at the back. This is not the time to be chopping and changing in there. You know, even despite the fact I've had a couple of indifferent results.
It's amazing how quickly things change, though, because obviously the last time we did this podcast, we were on the back of the Wraith defeat, and we've already skipped over the really good win against Queen's Park. Which saw them kind of go behind and then show
they
a bit.
Thought they'd put their home travails to bed.
Yeah, they showed a bit of character in that game, the going behind, because the pressure really would have been on at that point after losing to Wraith, and they came back. By the time we do a podcast next week, they'll play two games again. So, I mean, things could have changed completely by that point. As kind of Craig was saying, I'm not wholly convinced that Wraith Rovers are going to take advantage of any slips that United make, because they haven't. So far, United didn't really take any advantage of the race slipping up either.
It'll be interesting to see. I think if you look at it, I think it's fair to say that Wraith Rovers have the easier of the two games. No disrespect to Arbroath, but it's a tough one for Arbroath playing 3 days, you know, after a part-time team coming back in and playing on the Friday night again after taking a bit of a doing. Yeah, so it'll be interesting to see if Wraith can get a bit of form going and get 3 points on the board for that one. Like,
they have to be looking at it. It's a great
chance to put pressure on United.
Not just to get 3 points, but get their, as you say, their form lifted to back what it was earlier in the season.
Just to go back to the Ross Graeme thing, I think the performance against Raith did make it more difficult for Goodwin to make that decision, because I think he was always intending to bring Gallagher back in when he was fit. But yeah, Graeme had a difficult time against Morton and then responded and was very good until he came out the team after that. But I think when you're in a title race as tight as this, I think it's about getting your best players on the park. And I think it will be Gallagher and Holt unless there are injuries towards the end of the season.
Yeah, and the problem for Ross Graeme isn't just how good Declan Gallagher and Kevin Holt have been this season. It's that their level of experience as well, isn't it? Yeah, it'd be very, very hard to leave these two, either of these two, out when they're fit. To me, I mean, I was watching the Liverpool game last night, and Ali McCoist made a general point about Liverpool and Arsenal. If they're going to succeed, for all the great attacking players they've got, it's probably their centre-half pairings that will win them trophies between now and the end of the season. And I do tend to think that. And that's my biggest reason for not being in a darkened room and panicking about United, is I still look at that defence and think, that's a defence that wins leagues.
Yeah, in fairness, they've got the best defensive record in the league. You know, they've been bar one or two
Probably the best goalkeeper in the league as well.
Yeah, so, yeah, that gives you real encouragement, because for a while, and, you know, for a long time, Raith Rovers have been guilty of shipping goals left, right and centre. But for a while, they were coming out on the top with, you know, seven goal thrillers, Raith would edge it, you know, but you can't maintain that. They'll not be able to maintain that in the last run of games. It's the team that has the best defensive record will win this title. You just wonder if, you know, if Jim Goodwin will revert to experience and just put all his experience. We're talking about experience at the back, but is he going to persevere with Mo and Watt in the team together? You know, get all your Sybil Dockery, just get all your experienced men in, and hope that they can guide you over the line. I think you're hoping as well that somebody finds a spark. I think that's what we're waiting for. United were doing well earlier in the season. They were getting goals from all over the park. But if United can find someone, just need one of their forward players, you know, whether it's Moult or Watt, you know, can come up with something. Kai Fotheringham can come up with goals on a regular basis.
His goals have dried up, haven't they? I think that's maybe been part of what's happened in the past few weeks.
Which has Fotheringham
and Fotheringham, I think that's
why he found himself out of the team. But he's a young lad, he's an exciting young talent, you know.
It's not a criticism because he's had a great season. But I mean,
so he's another one that I mean, I know what I've said about experience, but he's another one that I would always be tempted to play just because he keeps going back. Misses don't seem to bother him, and I always like the positions he takes up in the final third. I always think he might not be involved in the game because the ball's not coming down his side, or he might be having a bad game, but he's always taking up really good positions. And I again, at this time of the season, I think, well, that doesn't matter how bad you're playing, the ball drops in front of you and you can see the goal, have a shot's on.
Yeah. And I think that's where we're at now with United. I think Jim Goodwin, when he's looking at, he's got the biggest squad in the Championship. He's got a lot of players that he can, you know, put in and bring out. But I think we're now looking at who's done it for me in the past, who's done it for me this season, who's the man I would trust to get me a goal when I really need one. And I think Fotheringham is, when you're talking about guys like they're bringing Matty Cujo, you know, I like Matty Cujo as a player and he started the season really well, but I still think Fotheringham is more likely to get a goal when it's required.
Another thing I'd like to see, and I mean, I managed last week's podcast, I managed to completely forget his goal against Raith, but I don't think there's the fear factor around Louis Moult for opposition defences that there was before Christmas. And I would like to see him back to bossing central defenders the way he was earlier in the season. And he's still chipping in with goals, but he was just, when the ball went to him, you could see that defences were very alert and very worried. And I haven't had that sense in the last couple of months.
To be fair to that, I mean, he did score against Raith. He did score an absolute screamer against Queen's Park.
Yeah, yeah.
But because of Louis Mote, what he's done in his career, you expect that a wee bit more. And I'm a wee bit scared.
I've become a modern manager where the number nine doesn't just have to... I mean, goals are almost secondary at times. It's what he does for the team. I think that I don't know, and I maybe being unfair to him, but I just think he's a wee bit lacking from his overall performance that was there earlier in the season that made United really feared when they got into the other team's half.
I think I probably agree with that, exactly what you're saying, and it's up to the manager and his coaching staff to rekindle that sort of spark, not just within Mo, but within, you know, Tony Waters. You sometimes look at Mo and Tony Watt and ask yourself, okay, do they really play together? I don't know if that works as well, but we're getting the stage. Tony Watt can come up with the goods we've seen at every level of football. He produces moments of magic that the other clubs in the Championship just don't possess. So, when you're on the home straight, I would go with your bankers, and Mo and Watt for me, you know, at this point in time, do have to play.
Another worry for United this week, David Witherspoon took a knock.
Yeah, he went off early in the Queen's Park game with a calf strain. Asked Jim Goodwin about it after the Airdrie game, and he said the Thistle game this Saturday will probably come a bit too soon for him, but they're hoping to have him back in next week. So it's not a serious injury, but he probably won't be involved on Saturday.
And again, it's one of these things, really great player, you want him available every week, but if he's going to miss a game, it's possibly you want it to be an away game, because maybe he's... biggest worth to United is doing what they haven't been able to do too often, is break teams down at Tannadice.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I like David Witherspoon. I think he's a brilliant signing for United, but he did come with a bit of a track record of, you know, injuries, and certainly you don't want to be taking a risk. You know, there are 10, 11 games to go, whatever it is. You don't want to be risking a player and putting him out, you know, for the running. It's always too valuable for them. So one game off, so he doesn't tweak anything and get him going again, that would be ideal.
Although, having said that, of the two games that are coming up before we pod again next week, you suspect that the Thistle game will be a much more open game?
I think so, but Morton are a bit different this season, I think. Last season they were really, really strong defensively. This season they seem to score quite a lot more goals. Even though that's largely the same team, I think, in terms of the big players anyway. On Saturday, getting a hold of Brian Graeme, I think, is the main thing for United against Partick. He seems to be in really good form at the moment. Keeps popping up with goals, even ones that get disallowed from offside, questionable offside in recent weeks. But
that's because they were both onside.
I quite enjoyed that. I have to say,
George has been on jury duty this week, by the way. It's a new George. He's weighing up all the evidence.
No, I just liked that there was no VAR and everyone was going a bit mental about the decision. I thought it was great drama and entertainment. We don't really talk about that.
It's quite refreshing. Quite refreshing to see players chasing after the referee.
So I'm not entirely convinced by Partick Thistle this season. I know they're third.
They're a good watch, but...
Aye, but I think you can get them, and I think United can get them.
Conceded a lot of goals in the last few matches. Yeah. If Dundee United click, then there's goals to be had there. They're on a bit of a poor run at the moment. There's times where this fixture would have looked a lot more difficult, I would say.
Even just a week ago, 2 weeks ago.
Yeah, before the last two results, basically,
I'm... also think last season it was Raith, and that they were stuck between too far from the playoffs and too far from the bottom. Partick are almost now, after that defeat last Friday against Dunfermline, Partick are now, they're in the playoffs. They're not going to finish first.
I don't know, and
they're not going to finish fifth.
They're only 6 points.
I think you're right, Tom. I think they are in a position. They need to be careful. I think, though, I mean, as we've seen in the past, how important it is if you're not going to finish in the top two, get yourself into third at least. Yeah. Like, you know, finish as high up as you possibly can. And you want to be going into the playoffs in a positive frame of mind. Morton are on an absolutely fantastic run. And we knew Morton's position at the start of the season was false. We knew Dougie Imrie and the players that he still had at the club, they were a better team.
I didn't think their coolest draw at Starks Park was a terrible result for Raith.
No, not at all. And Morton came with a late run last year, and they were within a whisker. I mean, Dundee, that game at Dens that we've already touched on, I had to win that game at Dens, they would have been right in the mix. Not just for a playoff slot, they still had title aspirations.
Mm-hmm. They only finished the season six points behind Dundee.
That's right, and I think they missed outside the playoffs because the game at Inverness at the last. Inverness scored a last.
Were they not in the playoffs in the last 10 minutes or something?
Something like that.
Out of them in injury time or something.
It was a sore one for Dougie Imrie.
Although everybody except Raith on that final night was either relegated or promoted at one point in the night.
Yeah, but they're a tough side, and. First and foremost, for United, they've got to take care of business at Partick. And it's a ground where they've had a reasonable amount of success. You know, like Craig says, I think there's goals to be had for Dundee United on Saturday. We haven't watched Partick against Dunfermline. There's definitely goals for Dundee United to be had, you know. So,
it's that bizarre thing about United this season, though. When they're away from home, if you say United will keep a clean sheet, you say 3 points. Mm. At home, when you say United will keep a clean sheet, you say, well, it might be 3 points, but it could be a point as well. And it was a word I saw in your report that Jim Goodwin used, I think, was frustration. It must be getting really frustrating for them.
Yeah, and also you mentioned the fans earlier, I think for them as well, because if you think about it, if you buy a season ticket and your team's absolutely imperious away from home, and then you're served up, sometimes that can be down to teams sitting in, as was alluded to earlier. I saw that with Dunfermline in League One last season. Certainly wasn't the case against Airdrie. But yeah, it's definitely frustrating when you see how well they have done on the road that you can't give that to the paying customers that turn up in their thousands at home.
So Craig's basically saying, don't buy a season ticket, buy a train ticket.
You try to get me banned.
That's you banned!
While Alan's on holiday.
And before we switch over, I believe I managed to miss this, I must admit, but I believe my old mucker Dave Bowman's back doing what he does best.
It's a surprise, wasn't it?
Got a red card, did.
Yeah,
Goodwin had been booked not too long before that, and the Airdrie Twitter account, because we were getting asked by loads of people afterwards, Goodwin had been sent off. I think the Airdrie Twitter account put out that he had been sent off, but it wasn't. It was shown to Davey Bowman on his bench. Yeah, I think he kicked something or something like that.
Although, in fairness as well, I'll always defend Bow. Is there not that thing now where the referees are told to pick one if they know something went on? So it might not have been him.
he might just
have been a victim of his
usual suspect. Yeah.
He's an easy target, Dave. Yeah, I think so. As good as, you know what? I love Dave Bowman just for the passion that he continues to show after all these years. Maybe we've got to channel it in the right direction, but, you know, he's still passionate about Dundee United and what he does at that club, and he wants the team to do well. So that's not a bad thing.
And I must admit, I quite like the policy of booking players for dissent, because I think there needs to be, it's up to us to criticise the referees, there needs to be more respect for referees in the game, on the park. But when you're talking about a guy that might be 20 years older than the referee, I think there maybe should be a wee bit more leeway.
You think? No. I mean, you just want to be able to say whatever you want to the referee.
That might
definitely deserve a red card.
I'd give you a yellow card if I could then. Anyway, that's all for United.